We will be guiding you as much as we can, because remember, I will be one person, you will be 100, 200 people. So I will be guiding you as much as I can. If you're, we will be in different coaches. We don't have a coach for 100 people, we have a coach for 50 people. If you're on my coach, then you'll hear me. There'll be somebody else in a different coach, they will try and guide you as much as they can according to their knowledge. Okay? So what I'm trying to tell you is read as much as you can, try and grasp as much as you can. Whatever I'm saying, try and take it as much as you can and read afterwards as well. But this is what you're supposed to do. Okay? So once you've made your intention in Tarbiyah, now you are in Ihram, all the restrictions of Ihram, now you have to make sure you don't do it. You can't cut your nails, you can't pull your beard, you can't cover your head. You don't make, if you have made your salah and your head is covered, men, then you take off your topi and then you make your intention. Because then you are doing something which is not allowed. Okay? Men should read Tarbiyah in an audible tone, women should read Tarbiyah quietly. Labbayk Allahumma labbayk, so that you can hear. Allah can hear. As soon as one has made intention, recite Tarbiyah, all restrictions on Ihram now apply. Every time you are ascending, descending, joining a party of people, after every salah in the morning and evening, Tarbiyah is continuous. That's the best zikr during the Hajj. Labbayk Allahumma labbayk. And be conscious of what you're saying. That will help you in concentrating on your Hajj. Now, arriving in Jeddah, this is only for those people who are going to Jeddah directly. So, majority are going to Medina Munawwara, and over there, Shabir, do we give our drafts at Medina Airport?
This is in the passport.
Yeah. You will be given, everyone has paid for a draft. This is what a draft looks like. Okay? These are stapled in your passport. Please do not lose your draft. They took them out or they separated it. These are stapled in your passport, you keep it together. The reason is this draft is your transport to Mecca, Medina, Mina, Muzdalifah. That's what you've paid for. What happens is that when they take your passport over there, they will take out the draft, the Saudi authorities will take out the draft, and they will put stickers in your passport which represent your journey from Medina to Mecca. Mecca to Mina, Mina to Muzdalifah, Muzdalifah to Arafat, Arafat to Mina, Arafat to Muzdalifah, Muzdalifah to Mina. That draft has been swapped and stickers have been put in your passport for that draft. If that draft is not there, nobody's going to put stickers in there. And then we have to buy a different draft and the group is not going to pay for it if you've lost it. Okay? So in your passport, these drafts are very important, you keep them there. Okay? They represent your transport. If you come to Jeddah, patience. If you come to Medina, patience. But you need less patience in Medina because it's a smaller airport, less people come in there. Okay? Those people who are short fuse, change your journey to Medina. The journey to Mecca from Jeddah, if you're going, although only 50 miles, takes hours due to congestion, administration, nature of life. Patience is a virtue. Now, once you near Mecca, now pretend we are going from Medina to Mecca. Once, if we're going from Medina to Mecca, then normally it's a 4, 5, 6 hour journey. Hajj time, 24 hour journey. Okay? I'm trying to prepare you mentally. Yeah? Don't think that, oh, you know, it's only our coach that is taking 24 hours. Every coach will take 24 hours. Okay? So when we're going from Medina to Mecca, be prepared for a 24-hour journey. Yeah? If we get there in 12 hours, Alhamdulillah. Then you'll be so happy. Hell, we got there in 12 hours. But if we get there in 16 hours, oh, Malisab said 24 hours, so we'll still come here early. 24 hours in your mind. Medina to Mecca, 24 hours. We will stop on the way. We'll do some stops for cafe. But the cafes are not like the M1. And the toilets are definitely not like your home toilets or the M1. Yeah? So if I were you, I'd eat less 2 days before. Yeah? Write this down, you remember me. Eat less so that you do not have to go on the journey. Yeah? Those toilets are like maybe 50, 100 years ago in India or Pakistan. Yeah? Those are the kind of toilets. And they've been used by other people who've been before you. Yeah? So if I were you, you don't want to go to any of those toilets on the services going from Medina to Mecca. 24-hour journey. We will stop off at Zulhulaifa. We will pray our two rakat salah there and make our intention there. Then we will get on the coach, and then when we go, we will be on the journey, we will keep on stopping. And then when we get to Mecca, the first stop is made at European office. European offices. At the European office, our passports are taken by the group and they are given into the office. And the passports never stay with us, whether it's Medina or Mecca, they take it off us. Okay, so don't worry about your passports. But the offices that take them, they will give you a card. And that card will have the number of the office where the passport is gone. If you look outside the office number, and that card number will be the same. So you keep that card with you because Shabir or Ibrahim will ask you, where's your passport, which office? Most probably they will know. But just in case, there might be two or three people whose passports have gone to a different office. We need to know where your passports are. So when we're leaving Medina, we have to take out those passports. When we're leaving Mecca, we need to take out those passports. So we need to know which European office are your passports. The Saudi authorities will come in and they will give you some ID bands, red bands. Put them on your wrist. That band represents where you will be in Mina, where you will be in Arafat, where you will be in Muzdalifah. It's got the number on them. Okay? So keep that band. They will give you an ID card that also has the location of where you will be in Mina, Muzdalifah, Arafat. Okay? Again, this might take an hour or two. So although you're in Mecca and you're thinking, oh, now we're going to get there now. But you'll be on the coach for another couple of hours because they're sorting out your passports. So again, patience. Yeah? Once completed, Mecca should be acting very humbly with the heart fully conscious of the grandeur of Almighty Allah. One should be continuously engaged in reciting the tarbiyah. We will not be going to Mecca at any of the hotels in Mecca. We will be going to Shisha. There's a building in Shisha. Shabir will mention about the building. But it's about 45 minutes, 1 hour's walk from Mecca. And that's the building that we will be staying in during our Hajj days and just before the Hajj days. Now, once you get to the, I won't call it a hotel because it's not a hotel, it's a hostel. Okay? And Shabir will describe a zero-star hostel for you. Okay? But if one is really tired and it is not Salah time, it is advisable to rest before performing Umrah. Now, most probably, we are going to get there on Jummah, on the day of Jummah. Yeah? The Hajj might start on Sunday, the 8th of Zulhijjah might be Sunday, so we might get into Shisha on Friday. Forget it on Friday, some of you might think, oh, I'm going to the Haram to perform Jummah. If you are strong enough, remember it's 1 hour's walk from our hostel, then fine. You might find a scooter that's going through the tunnel, you pay 50 riyals, which is about 10 pounds, get onto the back of the scooter, they might take you 5 minutes. Okay? But that's, you might think that's too much to pay.
You don't provide transport?
No transport from Shisha to we don't provide transport. It's very difficult, that's why we don't take that responsibility.
Are you saying an hour's walking time at normal times or an hour of time at peak?
Normal times. It's about 45 minutes. When I walked quickly last year, it took me 25 minutes. Okay? But that's because I trained before I went. And you don't know how much, you know, I do the marathon. I don't look like it.
Between Shisha to
Haram. It's about 45 minutes normal walk, 25 minutes quick walk, 1 hour for people who are just walking a bit slowly. Sometimes two, but normally one. Sometimes two. I've done with two. Okay? I'm going to carry on. So, from, you need to decide when are you going to do Umrah or are you going to do Hajj Ifrad? Those people who are doing Qiran and Tamattu, you will be doing Umrah first. Okay? So, you need to go to Haram. Now, when are you going to go to the Haram? Some of you might think, oh, I want to get there for Jummah, so you go there straight away. You don't take any rest. Fine. That depends on your own fitness. Okay? Now, don't think that we are going to go as a group of 100 to Haram. It doesn't work like that. Doing Tawaf in the 100 is very, very difficult. If you've been before, then I would recommend that you go yourself. Because Umrah is the same. You do your tawaf, you do your sa'i. It's the same. If you haven't been before, then try and find somebody who's gone before and try and group, go in a smaller group. Group of 5, 6, 7, 10, maximum 10, 12, 12 maximum, I would say. But that's still a big group. But if you are going in a group of 4, 5, it's better. You'll be able to look after yourself and you'll be able to do your Umrah properly. Okay? If you haven't done it before, try and find somebody. If you have done it before, then try and go yourselves. You go to the Haram in your own time. So either you go at night or you go during the daytime, it's your choice. Once you go, remember you should be, even if you remain in your hostel, then try and read your salah in the local masjid with Jamaat. There's a local mosque outside, try and read the Jamaat. Okay? Don't forget where you are. Okay? You still want to read all your salah with Jamaat. Also, whilst in your hostel, don't think that, remember you are in Ihram. So continuously keep yourself busy in dhikr. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka. And if you set targets of reading so much Quran, then start reading Quran. Or get your tasbih and start reading tasbih. Don't chit chat. Very important. Now, if you have, if on reaching Makkah, it is mustahab to perform ghusl. If not, then perform wudu and remember not to violate the laws of Ihram. Okay? So you can perform ghusl at the hostel. It's going to be a shared facility, so it depends on how many people need to use it. What's the name?
Where is line of post? Some people get lost on the way to.
Yeah, we're going to try and give you a map. We don't have a map from the authorities. So we will try and draw you a map of the main areas around Shisha to give you an idea of point A, point B, point C, point D. And then it will make it easy. Okay, and I'll give you an idea of where we're going. Okay, so this is Masjid al-Haram, and you've seen many pictures of this. So, in terms of Masjid al-Haram, there's the Kaaba. Sorry, this is Dar al-Tawheed Hotel, Hilton Hotel. This is the clock tower over here. Yeah, this is Safa and this is Marwa. Opposite clock tower is the King Abdulaziz Gate, gate number one. Okay? Now, Shisha is in between Safa and Marwa, and you come from here. There's tunnels here, pedestrian tunnels. So, when you come out, you will come out over here. And you will come round here and you will see in between Marwa over here and Safa over here. And you will come round over here and you will, it's better to enter through King Abdulaziz Gate, it's more easier. Because as you can see, it's the shortest distance to the Mataf. Shortest distance to the Mataf. Okay? So you will come from here if you are walking from Shisha through the pedestrian tunnel and you will come round and you will need to come towards Safa and come towards the clock tower, you can't miss the clock tower. So come towards the clock tower and then enter through that gate. Okay? Once you've entered through that gate, so nobody's going to miss the clock tower. Everybody knows where the clock tower is. So you will come from here and you will see the clock tower over here. So you walk around, walk around, walk down. Here's the clock tower. Enter through this gate and now you are in the masjid.
You come through
the tunnels? Tunnels, you will come through here. The tunnels are over here. Shisha is over here about 45 minutes walk on this side. Okay? So you will come and then you will come out of the pedestrian tunnel and you will come out over here. It's okay, sir. Now, this is, so the first thing we're going to do is going to make tawaf. So how do you make tawaf? Remember, all the things that you need to do for entering the masjid, you will take off your shoes, you will put them in the bag. Take off your left shoe first, then your right, put it into a bag. And the bag, you don't put in any of the shoe racks over there. Why? Because you will enter through this gate here. And then you will finish over here. Marwa. Who's going to come back with their shoes over here? No one. So you will have a kind of a pump bag which you will keep with you all the time. So your shoes will be with you all the time whilst making tawaf, whilst making sa'i. Okay? And this is a picture of the Kaaba. There's Hajar al-Aswad. This is the Hatim, which you need to go around. Okay, so you need to go around. No shortcuts through here. Some people, they're tired and say, I'm sure the shortcut might be. No, then your tawaf will not come. This is the Maqam Ibrahim. This is the Yemeni corner over here. These are the two main things. Hajar al-Aswad, Yemeni corner, Hatim, you need to go around. And this is Maqam Ibrahim. This is the door of the Kaaba. This is a multazam in between Hajar al-Aswad and the door here. So you're already in Ihram for Umrah, and wuzu is necessary for tawaf. Wuzu is necessary for tawaf. So if you've done your wuzu at Shisha, you walk through the tunnels, you've broken your wuzu, you do wuzu again before you go into the masjid. Tawaf, you need wuzu. While reciting Talbiyah, enter Masjid al-Haram with the right foot, reciting the Masmoon Dua. One should look down and proceed forward and recite Talbiyah until one can see the Kaaba. So you are walking, walking, looking down, whether it's 5 of you or 10 of you, you're looking down, and then from the top of your eye line, you can see the Kaaba, so you move to one side, leave that path for other people, you move to one side, and then you look up, and you look up at the Kaaba. Any dua you make whilst looking at the Kaaba, your dua will be accepted. So that dua is very important. Make long dua. You say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, 3 times. You say, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, 3 times. And then you recite durood and then make lots of dua. Make lots of dua. Everything that you need in this world and in the hereafter, you ask them. Don't rush. This is why I say don't take a big group. If you take a big group, one person finishes their dua in 5 minutes. Hurry up, man. And the other person wants to make long dua. So what do you do? Okay, so you need to make sure that you have that comfort of making dua, long dua. And at the end, one last dua you make, oh Allah, whatever dua I make after this, accept it. Because you might have forgot some duas, and if this dua is accepted, all your next duas will be accepted. Okay? This is one of the places where the dua is accepted. So how do you make your tawaf? So there's no more start line here. But you will enter through King Abdulaziz Gate. King Abdulaziz Gate is around this side, between the Shami corner and around Yemeni corner here. Okay? So you will enter here. You've made your dua over here, and now you are ready for tawaf. The men, they will uncover their right shoulder. Because now you're going to make your tawaf and sa'i afterwards. Okay? And you will make your intention that, oh Allah, I am making tawaf for you, for my umrah, accept it from me and make it easy for me. That's it. Very simple. In your heart, you already know you're making dua, but if you say it with your tongue, it's fine. Then you will start walking towards the black stone. Opposite the black stone, there's a green light over here. That's where the black stone is. There's a green light. Opposite that, that is where the black stone is. Now, when you're walking towards the black stone, you need to look at where, usually that's where the majority of the crowd is. The biggest crowd is over here, between here and here. Biggest crowd. Between here and here and here and here. Then it's much more easier to do your job here, and then again it gets congested here. So you're walking, you're walking, you're walking, and then you will, when you feel your opposite, now if that pillar over here is a Hajar al-Aswad, and I'm going to use this pillar here, so if I'm walking all the way from here, then I will try and stand in front of the Hajar al-Aswad. Now you can forget about going to kiss the Hajar al-Aswad. Yeah, because that's impossible. Too much crowd. Okay? You can forget going to touch it, especially when you're doing your first tawaf. Forget. So you are going to stand in front of it. What are you going to do? So like I said, if device to uncover the right shoulder, wuzu is necessary for tawaf, proceed towards the black stone. The talbiyah, labbaik will stop when you get to the black stone. So you carry on playing labbaik, 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 all the way till the black stone. Then your intention, oh Allah, I'm performing tawaf, I'm going to make it easier to accept it from you. Step in line with the black stone and with the body facing it, there are two actions that need to be done. Now, in one hand, the Prophet ﷺ says that the tawaf is like salah, it's like namaz. So just like you start salah with takbir, you're going to start your tawaf with takbir. Okay? So you come towards the Hajar al-Aswad, and then you stand in front of it, you say, Bismillah Allah. Or Allahu Akbar la ilaha illallah. There's different narrations. Some have said you say Bismillah Allahu Akbar wa lillahi alhamd. Someone said you say Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah. Someone said you say Allahu Akbar. Whatever is written in your book, it is fine. It is found in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said Allahu Akbar, and you let your hands down. And then it is sunnah to kiss the Hajar Aswad. So first you have done takbir to start the tawaf. And you do that every time you start a tawaf, you do the takbir. According to some scholars, you don't do takbir, you only do the kissing of the Hajar Aswad. So if that's what's written in your book, that is fine as well. But according to Imam Hanifa, you start with the takbir, you let your hands down. Once you, then you have to kiss the Hajar Aswad. Because you can't kiss it, you touch it. Because you can't touch it, then you put your hands towards it and you kiss your hands. And that's your kissing the Hajar Aswad. Bismillah, Allahu Akbar. And then you carry on. That's your first kiss of the Hajar Aswad. And then you put your left shoulder towards the Kaaba and you start walking around. All the way around the Kaaba. So you started here, you did your takbir first, you let your hands down, and then you pointed your hands towards Hajar Aswad, and then you said Allahu Akbar, and you kiss your hands, and now you put your left shoulder towards the Kaaba and you start walking around. And you start making, either you can read Quran, you can make dua, whatever you want to read, there's no fixed reading. Okay, read whatever you want, don't make any shortcuts here, and you go around. The Yemeni corner, if you are next to it, so if you are next to it, then you are allowed to touch it like this. This is called istilam of Yemeni corner. But if you are next, not next to it, then there is no waving to it, or there is no kissing to it from a distance. Hajar al-Aswad, if you are not next to it, then you kiss it from a distance. This Yemeni corner, you only touch it if you are next to it, otherwise nothing. Then when you come to Yemeni corner, to the black stone, in between here, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ is the masnoon dua to read between Yemeni corner and black stone. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Once you get to the black stone again, that's your one round done. Seven rounds make one tawaf. Seven rounds make one tawaf. Once I was asked the question, why is it seven? Why is it seven? Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He likes the number seven, seven heavens, seven earths, lots of things are seven. But the usual answer I give is that if we were ten, then you would ask me the question, why is it ten? If it was eight, then you say, oh, Malana, why is it eight? So Allah said it's seven, so it's seven. You don't have to ask questions like this. If it's seven, Allah said it's seven. Okay? So رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. When you get to the black stone again, you face towards the Kaaba if you can. There's a lot of congestion. If you can't face, then you can just